What's up, friendly neighborhood nerds? This is Judah Rad. It's just me today. We don't have Robo, we don't have Ree, so I'm going to do my best here. I'm in Las Vegas right now for this stupid class, and I would say I hate Vegas. This is like my 20th time here, and this is the worst place. I'm sorry if you live here and you love it, that's great. I was not made to survive in 115 degree weather. It's just not me. I need a solid 75 to 85. So what are you going to do? Anyway, we have a very special guest today. Joining us is editor-in-chief of Fanbase Press, Barbara Dillon. Barbara, how's it going?
Hi, Judah. I'm good. How are you? Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you so much for joining us. So before we even get into like questions, just what's new? How's life?
I'm good. I commiserate with the heat. I'm in Los Angeles and it's like 100 degrees here. It's nowhere near what it is in Vegas. So I'm very sorry that you were dealing with that heat right now. Things are good. I have twin 6-month-olds. And so that has kind of overtaken my life right now. But other than that and no sleep, everything is good.
Yeah. So no big deal, right?
No big deal. It's fine.
Right on. So I want to talk about Fanbase Press. I read Nuclear Power, which first two issues, really, really cool. And, I watched some kind of promotional videos that you had. I'd like to kind of just, for our audience understand, what Fanbase Press is and what kind of sets them apart from other publishers.
Absolutely. So Fanbase Press is a comic book publishing company as well as a geek culture website. We have been around for 11 years now. In addition to being the editor-in-chief, I'm also one of the co-founders. And why we started the company and have sort of a dual purpose is that not only are we creators ourselves, we have creative backgrounds, having worked in the TV and film industry as well as in theater. So we have stories that we want to tell, but we love supporting other creators as well. There are so many talented individuals out there who, you know, may never get the opportunity to, in the comic book industry, work for the Marvels, the DCs. There are only so many people that can do so, but that in no way, you know, minimizes their talent. Folks to be able to share those wonderful stories, to be as positive, as inclusive as possible. So we hope to be able to share those, you know, stories, whether publishing on our own or just providing daily reviews, interviews, and podcasts for them to share that information with readers.
Cool. So everyone has a story to tell.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that's the important thing for us is that so many people do have such wonderful stories, and especially marginalized creators who may not usually have opportunities like that or face a lot of barriers. We want to really break down those barriers and use the resources we have to give them the platform to do so.
That's awesome. And your slogan is celebrating fandoms and creating new ones.
That's correct.
Where'd that come from? Tell me about that.
Thank you. Since we do have sort of a dual purpose to our company, both publishing comics and supporting other creators through a variety of means, we wanted to easily encapsulate and for all of our readers and followers to know who we are and what we're about right from the get-go. And so since we celebrate all fandoms, you know, whether it be comics, movies, TV, we often talk about science, technology, crafting. So, you know, everyone can be a fan of something and we want to celebrate that. And then we create new ones because we provide the opportunity to share new stories through our publishing line, which may become a fandom for someone new someday.
That's awesome. That's a good answer, because my next question is going to be, what are some fandoms that you would like to create?
Sure. I mean, if any of our titles become fandoms unto themselves, then wow, what an amazing feat that is. One of the things that we are best known for is a series called Quince, which is about a teenager who gets superpowers on her quinceañera, but only for the year that she is 15. And we've been very, very grateful and honored that it's been well received. We put out the series 15 issues in honor of Quince in both English and Spanish. And it was Eisner Award nominated. It's been nominated for a variety of awards, both in its trade paperback form as well as the recent hardcover, which contains both the English and Spanish versions. But it's been amazing to see so many readers connect with and respond to it and have it be such an impactful story. So if there can be a Kinsei fandom, that is amazing, and I'll take it, absolutely.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So you run this company along with your partner. Yes. I want to know what's that conversation like where you just decide to do this? Was it like, if it was in the movie, what would that scene, set the scene for me?
Totally. So we both we met in college on the East Coast, and we both came out to California, to work in TV and film in a variety of roles. I was going to work in, which I did for a number of years, talent management and production, and he was going to act. And we both got very jaded working out here in Los Angeles in the entertainment industry. We really saw the belly of the beast. So, yes. And in leaving the industry, but still staying here, we made so many wonderful contacts and friends in the comic book community. And both of us having grown up on comics and really loved comics, we thought, you know, this would be really cool if we could tell our own stories, but also in doing so, support our friends, you know, that were making comics or other media. And that's kind of where it was born. We work really, really well together, which, you know, husband and wife team, sometimes they need to have their own activities, but we both love all of the same things. We both love movies, pop culture of all kinds, comics, etc. So being able to work so closely with one another in this company has just been super fun and very rewarding and fulfilling. So we love it.
So on the subject of just being a fan of stuff, you mentioned that you have twins.
Yes.
what order? This is a very important question. What order do you show them the Star Wars movies in?
Oh, 4, 5, 6. Just standard. Yeah, we've already had this conversation. This is okay. Just like,
these are the important things you work out.
You know, before you get the wills, you know the birth certificates, you have to figure out which order you're showing them in. Yes, we will be starting with 4, 5, 6, and then the prequels, and then the sequel series. Absolutely.
But that's a fine answer. That's a very good answer. We haven't had this talk yet, but We're going to have kids at some point. My kind of idea that I just have in my head right now, I'll bounce it off of you, is 4, 5, and then 1, 2, 3 is a flashback before 6.
Ooh, fascinating. I'm going to have to think about that. I will have to think about that.
So we have the nuclear power team joining us soon. It's supposed to be next week, and we rescheduled, but we're going to figure it out. We're going to talk to them soon. It's the only fan-based press work that I've read so far, and I liked it. It was good. What can you sort? And you mentioned the Quinceañera story, which I'm definitely going to check that out. Can you tell us about some of the other titles?
Sure. So I'll start with Nuclear Power. This is our active series right now. It's a 6-issue series that's currently releasing. We do all of our issue-to-issue series digitally first, month-to-month, and then we collect them in a printed trade paperback. So this one is co-written by Erica Harrell and Desiree Proctor, and they've come from the video game world. They wrote a lot of things like The Walking Dead Michonne, and Game of Thrones. And then they were both in the DC Talent Writers Workshop in 2017. And they met the artist of the series, Lin Yoshii, and decided to, you know, work together on the series. It's actually an alt history series about the Cuban Missile Crisis. Both Erica and Desiree's mothers are Cuban in descent. And this series was really inspired by their being forced to Americanize after leaving Cuba, and what that's like in terms of the xenophobia and, you know, the disinformation that they had to battle. So this series really tackles those themes head on and talks about, you know, which has become really prescient in the past few years.
Absolutely.
in terms of the disinformation, the xenophobia, et cetera. But we refer to it as The Handmaid's Tale meets the X-Men, because you're really dealing with a lot of very prescient and heavy themes. And we really we want there to be a message with all of our books. We want the stories to resonate with readers. We want the characters to really be impactful. So if this sounds at all intriguing, definitely check it out. Issue 4 drops this Wednesday on both Comixology and, if you have a library card, Hoopla Digital. You can get it for free through your library. And then the trade is available for pre-order right now. You can learn more at nuclearpowercomic.com.
And the artwork has like a very like kind of retro vibe almost. Kind of reminds me of, not entirely, like don't get the wrong idea, but it kind of reminds me of some of like the informational video like stuff from Fallout.
Yes. Yeah. It's that honestly is very purposeful. Lynn Yoshii, the artist, really wanted this because we're talking a lot about disinformation. The premise of the story is that it happens, basically, if we go back to the Cuban Missile Crisis, what would have happened if it went the other way and they did drop the nuclear bomb? So we pick up at the present time after the bomb had dropped in what is now America, but there are only so many states left because they have fallen victim to all of the nuclear radiation.
And the government's terrible.
Yes, and you have this authoritarian government and, you know, what they're forcing women to do and what, you know, just what that looks like afterwards. And so it really does take on this sort of propagandist poster feel, like you're mentioning, like mm-hmm. the Fallout look feel. And she has a very cool monochromatic style as well in terms of the color scheme. So she does an amazing job. Yeah,
definitely. So is starting a publisher hard?
Yes.
And what's the hardest part? Like for the folks at home that want to just start their own publisher.
Yes.
What can they expect?
That's a great question. So I say in jest, yes. It is hard, but it's totally worth it. If it's something that's of interest to you, it's also totally doable. The funny thing is, so back in the before times, before the pandemics, when we used to go to conventions, I would speak a lot on panels regarding self-publishing, the difference between self-publishing and submitting to a publisher, et cetera. And, you know, a lot of folks do have questions about like, hey, I'd love to submit my comic to Image Comics, you know, I'd love to have my comic published through them versus, you know, I want to do it all on my own. And I think that the thing that folks have to remember or to think about when they're considering how do you publish a comic is what are you able and willing to put in, not just financially, but just an investment of time and of yourself, you know, what is going to be too much for you to take on. And I think that that's really helpful to think about in addition to the fact of just a lot of the responses that I would hear from other folks in the industry is you have to do it this way. You have to, you know, if you want to self-publish, you have to use this paper. You have to do it in this format. And the funny thing is just like, you know, as we learn from the film industry or TV, there's no right or wrong. The funny thing is, you know, when someone does try something new and it works, everybody wants to do it that way. So I think that that's always a huge lesson to folks, no matter the medium they're working in, but especially if you're working in comics, do it however you want to do it. Obviously, there's some industry standards that will help you to succeed, but use those as guidelines and not mandates. You know, do it, you know, if you only have so much money, do what you can. If you can only go to Kinko's, or I'm dating myself, Kinko's, to FedEx office and print them out and staple them and give ash cans to people, do that. But the important thing is get your story out there, put it on paper, get it out there. And that's the most that anyone can ask you to do.
Does Fanbase Press own IP, or are all titles creator owned?
That's a great question. So all of our titles are creator owned, but the first two that we did were actually in-house. They were written all by right. my partner. So he owns the IP, but all of the other ones are creator owned. We're very much about supporting creator owned titles. Absolutely.
Cool. So it sounds kind of like Image in a lot of ways.
The big thing with us, and I'd say the difference with Image, is that we're very much a boutique publisher. We go from start to finish with the creative team. We'll start, meaning we'll take them from development, whether that's a germ of an idea or a written script, or if you already have your creative team together, all the way through the actual development and production process, printing. Cool. We do all of your marketing, selling, going to conventions, distribution, et cetera. So we only take on so many titles for that reason, that we want to be really mindful of our time and abilities to make sure that we're giving the team and the project as much of our attention as possible.
Meanwhile, Image is like, send us your pages and a bunch of money and we'll take care of the rest.
I didn't say that.
Where can we go to get these books? Are they, do you sell them online? Do you have them available digitally? Like, where can someone find Fanbase Press?
That's a great question. So first and foremost, I would recommend that folks go to fanbasepress.com. Easy enough. All of our titles are there. We have an online store that you can purchase them through. Likewise, if you're someone that likes Amazon, totally fine if you don't. All of our books are on Amazon in print as well. But if you're someone who likes digital comics, we are on Comixology. We are on Hoopla, as I mentioned. If you have a library card anywhere in the US, you can use Hoopla to read Fanbase Press's titles, all of them. And then we're also recently on Comics Plus as well. I know that this is a platform utilized by K through 12 schools and libraries. So if that's something, you know, if you have kiddos and they are interested in some of our all age or young adult titles, they're available through Comics Plus as well.
Cool.
Yeah.
So this is kind of the part of the interview where I'm like fishing, but
do it.
Do you have any news to break? What can we expect? what can we expect in the future
for
people to look forward to?
That's a great question. So I will first tell you that this week, currently, if the episode is coming out this week, we are currently running our first ever, what we're calling Celebrating Fandoms Week. And in light of the fact that, you know, all of convention panels are virtual, you know, these days, we have our own virtual convention going on. We're launching a new video panel every day. Today we launched a Batman versus Predator 30th anniversary retrospective panel. Dave Gibbons, who is the writer of Batman versus Predator, and of course the artist of Watchmen
artist.
But since he's the writer of the series, we were very fortunate to have him on. So you can hear the writer himself talk about the series 30 years later. So that's a really fun panel that's available. But go to fanbasepress.com. You can see our schedule of panels coming out every day this week. And I'll say that on Thursday, we are releasing a video announcement about our brand new series. I can't say anything about it yet because it'll come out on Thursday. But if you want to learn more about
already- it. We're already here. I mean,
I know. I wish that I could. I get in a lot of trouble. But yeah, so definitely it's a really fun week that we have going on, and it's all free, you know, all on fanbasepress.com through video. So definitely check it out.
Cool. Yeah. I will check that out. What have you, just forget about work for a second.
Yes.
What have you been geeking out on lately?
What have I been geeking out on? So with the girls, the twins, it's been a little even more difficult to consume media because I think it was hard to consume given the creation of all the media going on before the girls. But I did finally watch Invincible, which I really dug. I had read the comic book series, but I was waiting to see what the animated series was like, and I really liked it. The Bad Batch. I don't know if you're watching the Bad Batch.
It's awesome.
Star Wars has no right to be so amazing week to week, and I love it. So I'd say the Bad Batch I'm absolutely geeking out on.
I am a big Harrison Dula fan. So
I don't know if you can see it. I'm gonna turn my computer a little bit, but right over here, over my shoulder, I have Harry's family heirloom. So I love me some Hera.
Awesome.
Yes.
And speaking of your home, I see some black and white sketches.
So I don't know if the one in the middle is any indication. I'm a huge Hunger Games fan, like the books. I have to clarify. The books over the movies for me personally. Behind me, I may have come across, if I ever get like an actual movie item in my life, it will be some of Cinna's pages where he actually created the Mockingjay outfit, but I got some movie prop replicas that are printed out behind me. So you see behind me, yes.
Pretty cool. Well, yeah. I just want to say thank you so much for joining us. This is really fun. People watching, make sure that you, first, like and subscribe and ring the bell and do all that other stuff that we always ask you to do. But Furthermore, be sure to check out Fanbase Press. Definitely be sure to check out Nuclear Power. And stay tuned for more updates and news from Fanbase Press. It's a pretty cool publisher. Thanks so much, Barbara. Barbara Dillon, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. And stay safe. Continue social distancing. Wear a mask. Get vaccinated. Wash your hands. Do all that other stuff that you should be doing anyway. Anyway, thank you. Take care.
Thanks, Judah.
If you want to hear interviews from industry pros, get first looks, and have access to endless comic content, wake up. Please wake up. You're in a coma. Your mother misses you.